Hey everyone, grace to and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Tim Wright here, one of the pastors at Community of Grace Lutheran Church, coming to you from Peoria, Arizona. And we are continuing our series today on craze when every day is a manic Monday. And what's causing the craziness is all of these different things in culture right now vying for our attention, saying that this thing or that thing can give us a sense of worth and value, and it can shape our identity. And today, we move into politicized. So Russell Moore is the editor-in-chief of Christianity Today. Christianity Today is the flagship magazine of evangelical Christianity. It was founded, by the way, by Billy Graham. And if you know anything about Billy Graham, the late Billy Graham, you know that this thing has some street cred. And so he started out an editorial this way. He said, "Last week I was talking with a new believer in Christ, one who came from a thoroughly secular background, and she mentioned that some family members were really worried about her. 'I can't believe you've become an evangelical Christian,' one of them said. 'How can you be for guns?'" Guns? The family member assumed that her becoming an evangelical Christian meant she had joined a political tribe complete with gun culture views of assault weapons. But this new Christian happened to have the same political view on the issue as her family. Of all the things that changed in her conversion, her view on guns wasn't one of them. "My shoulders slumped when I heard this, and it wasn't because I agreed or didn't agree with this family's view on gun policy. My disappointment was because I had heard some version of this many times before. People who, when hearing about evangelical Christianity, think not of the gospel, but of some extreme political identity." And by the way, stories could be told about mainline progressive Christianity as well. A few years ago, as we were coming out of COVID, a number of us pastors, including myself, had this sense that a significant shift had taken place in the way that people engaged with a church or didn't engage with a church. Rather than engaging with their congregation based on its theology or its music, its style of worship, its children's programming or youth, or the preaching, or even the way it did outreach, people increasingly since COVID were choosing a church or engaging with a church based on what they believed to be the political affiliation of the church or the pastor. And so they were asking a question, and I'm putting it really crassly now, really crudely: is this church woke or MAGA? And then depending on how they thought that church would answer the question, they would either engage or not engage with that church based on its political views. Now, at the time, there was no research to back that up. It was just a sense that many pastors had from talking to a lot of people. It was anecdotal, but now we have the research. David Zoll has written a book called Seculosity, and here's what he says. "Studies indicate that religious identity now follows political affiliation rather than vice versa, which had been the pattern in the U.S. historically. Meaning that for more and more people, political convictions shape their religious beliefs, not the other way around." Back in 2017, a study was done of 20 different countries, and one of the questions was this: do you agree with the statement, "Religion has done more harm than good in the world"? And 39% of all Americans said, "Yes, I agree with that statement." That's 4 out of 10. In Britain, in Australia, it's 60% or more. Back to Russell Moore. He was being interviewed on NPR. He has a new book coming out on Christianity in crisis. When he was asked the question, "Why is Christianity in crisis?" here's what he said. "Well, it was a result of having multiple pastors tell me essentially the same story about quoting the Sermon on the Mount parenthetically in their preaching. For example, turn the other cheek. To have someone come up after and to say, 'Where did you get those liberal talking points?' And what was alarming to me is that in most of these scenarios, when the pastor would say, 'I'm literally quoting Jesus Christ,' the response would not be, 'I apologize.' The response would be, 'Yes, but that doesn't work anymore. That's weak.' And when we get to the point where the teachings of Jesus himself are seen as subversive to us," meaning us as Christians, "then we're in a crisis." Well, 2,000 years ago, a Jewish teacher, a Jewish rabbi, in a remote part of Rome, began to attract followers through a radical message. It was a countercultural, upside-down, subversive message. It was a message of radical love, lavish generosity, extravagant forgiveness, inclusive hospitality, compassionate action, selfless service, a passion for justice, creative nonviolence, and simple living. Now, when Jesus started sharing that message, when Jesus started his movement, he didn't come to start a political movement. He didn't come to align with a particular political party or political ideology. He came instead to change the world, all of the world. And his way for doing that was to send his followers out to live out this subversive message in the midst of the countries or political identities in which they found themselves, oftentimes in places that were antagonistic to that message, as was the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire, for all of its might, was so skittish at this message of Jesus, they killed him. But ironically, it was the death of Jesus, it was the cross and his resurrection that became the defining mark of the Christian movement. A movement that says that transformation in life happens not through political might, not through political policy, but through compassion, grace, death, and resurrection. Now, as soon as Jesus handed off this message and this mission to his followers, we as followers have struggled with the dual identities that we have. Our identity as a follower of Jesus, and our identity as a citizen. For example, one of the best ways to understand the book of Revelation is to see it as a letter to people written in Rome struggling with that very issue of identity. Would they identify as followers of Jesus? Would they call Jesus Lord? Would they bear the mark of the cross, possibly losing their life because of it? Or would they identify as a Roman citizen? Would they identify Nero as their lord, so to speak? Would they take on the mark of the beast, 666, which is the numerical number for Caesar Nero? Would they identify as Christian or as Roman? And we have struggled with that dilemma since the beginning of Christianity. And we have had a very difficult time over the last 2,000 years learning the hard lesson that when we compromise our faith with political ideologies or political power, we end up losing our influence and the call to be subversive. Every time, the Christian church has gotten too cozy with political power, the political power has corrupted the church. And every time we as Christians have filtered our faith through political ideologies rather than the other way around, we lose ourselves. And sometimes we end up on the wrong side of Jesus. Far too many Christians were on the wrong side of Jesus when it came to supporting slavery in the United States of America. Far too many Christians were on the wrong side of Jesus by supporting Nazism in Germany. And that story can be told over and over again in every country on the planet and still today in the United States of America. When Christians filter their faith through political ideologies, we lose our way, and sometimes we end up on the wrong side of Jesus. When we're motivated more by political outrage than compassion, when we see that person on the other side of the political spectrum as an enemy rather than the image of God, when we quickly condone in our party or our political candidate what we would quickly condemn in the other party or other candidate, and when we find ourselves doing all kinds of mental and spiritual gymnastics to justify voting for a particular person, party, or platform, those are the signs that we've lost our way. And those are the signs that we've lost our ability to influence a world of ungrace with grace, compassion, and mercy. Christianity has been around a lot longer than the constitutional democracy of the United States of America. Jesus has been around a lot longer than Donald Trump or Joe Biden. Well, maybe not that much longer, but he was here before them. Jesus is not a Christian. Jesus is not an American. Jesus is not an Australian. He is not a Brit. He is not a Rwandan, a Nigerian. Jesus is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and it was never his mission to Christianize any nation or country. That's not his purpose. Our purpose as his followers is not to make the United States of America a Christian nation. As followers of Jesus, we are called to live in the political systems we're born into subversively, to invite and to work toward making our country, our setting, more just, compassionate, generous, and good. That's our calling. Not to make this a Christian nation, but to make it good and compassionate. Now, there are a lot of ways that we can do that as Christian people. Some of us will be called to be actively engaged in the Republican or the Democratic Party. And it's our opportunity when we're involved in those parties to subversively work for policies and for ideas that are more compassionate and just. Some of us may choose to work on the outside advocating to helping these two political parties see their blind spots. Some of us may join with charities that are carrying out some of these mission objectives of Jesus. Of course, we can all vote. We can all pray for our country. We can be involved, and we can make a difference without losing our identity. When Jesus finally came face to face with the Roman Empire in the person of Pontius Pilate, he said to Pilate, "My kingdom is not of this world." Again, Jesus didn't come to start a political movement. His kingdom is beyond, it's above, it's below, and it's also actively in political systems subversively, not for political means, but for people like us, people who call Jesus our Lord and Savior, to be in there infiltrating with grace and mercy and compassion. What our country needs today from Christians is not fueling the flame of political outrage or hatred or grievance or divisiveness. What our country needs right now, desperately, is for Christian people to be Christian people, to infiltrate the culture around us, our neighborhoods, our countries, our cities, our states, to subversively bring this message of Jesus, of kindness and compassion, of treating others the way we want to be treated. If we want to love our country, that's the best way for us to do it. To love our country the way that Jesus does. To live out, first and foremost, our identity as followers of Jesus. The Apostle Peter wrote a letter to some Jewish Christians who were living under the Roman Empire, and he reminded them of their identity. He said, "You are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the excellence of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light." Or as we say in baptism, and this is said not just in the United States, but all over the world, you are a child of God. You've been sealed with the Holy Spirit and marked at the cross of Christ forever. Let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. That's what the United States of America needs today. People of light and grace. So let's love our country. And let's be people of subversive grace. Amen.
Of the voices of the wind.
On the night which is betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks. He broke it. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body broken for you. Eat this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink and said, "This is my blood. It's been poured out for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Drink this for the remembrance of me." Let's pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you, and for his sake, God forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained minister of the gospel, I declare to you the entire forgiveness of all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. As you eat that piece of bread or cracker, this is the body of Christ given for you. And as you drink the wine or the grape juice, this is the blood of Christ shed for you. And now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you unto everlasting life. Peace be with you. Amen. Well, thanks so much for joining us today for our worship service. Glad to have you with us as always. And if this is your first time joining us, we'd like to send you a gift to Starbucks. That's our way of saying thanks for joining us. Just text the word NEW to 623-295-2484. If you text the word PRAYER to that same number, we're going to pray for you. And if you'd like to know more about what's happening here online and in-house, you can text the word EVENTS, 623-295-2484. We'll send you a link to all the things that are happening here in terms of children and youth, Bible studies, and of course, not long from now, Christmas stuff coming up as well. So text the word EVENTS to 623-295-2484. Want to give you an update on what's happening with our friends in Niamata in Rwanda. We have been helping them to build a new church building. The government has come in and forced them to have to build a new building, put it up to code. And so we have sent them a gift over these last several months of about $10,000. And it's amazing what they can build over there with $10,000. So here's the inside of their brand new worship center. Isn't that amazing? I wish I'd had a picture, I just couldn't find it, of what their current worship center looks like. Seems to me that it was just dirt floors, if I remember right, but that looks immaculate. And they are so excited about being able to worship in their new church home, and in part because of our partnership with them. And that happens because of your giving, and we're impacting people all around the world with this radical message of God's love. So there's a church over there that's going to be able to share that message with people in Niemata because of you. And so if you believe in what we're doing together and you believe in this mission and ministry, you can text a gift in the message, type in how much you'd like to give, send that to 623-295-2484. You can hold your phone up with your camera on to that QR code, and that will take you to some prompts to fill out. And as always, you can go to boldrecklessgrace.org/giving. That's boldrecklessgrace.org/giving. And I know that there are a lot of things vying for your money and for your attention. But there are very few things in life that you can give to that will make a lasting difference and will be a way for us to be light in the world. So if you want to support this mission and ministry, I encourage you to do that. The text number there for you. And, of course, boldrecklessgrace.org/giving. Now, we are going to wrap up this particular series next week, and we're going to talk about the antidote to crazed. And we come to you every Saturday night, 5 o'clock, Facebook and YouTube. It's available for you on demand. We worship together in-house if you live in the area. Sunday mornings at 9 and 10:30, right in between those two services, is our Sunday school for kindergarten through fifth grade, and then middle school and high school meets after the 10:30 service. I do have a Go Bold, Live Grace assignment for you today. I've been doing that at the end of each of these sermons, and this one probably will be a no-brainer. This week, let's pray for our country. Let's pray for our elected leaders locally and statewide, and of course, nationally. We've got a big election coming up here in a year. And so let's pray not only for our country, but also for ways for us as Christians to be light and grace and compassion, and see how God might use us to be subversive in a pretty divided world right now. So that's your Go Bold, Live Grace assignment. So now as you go, may a loving Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face smile upon you and be gracious to you. And may the Lord always turn his face towards you and give you peace in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go bold and live grace.